Welcome to Lankyband, putting the English red road county of Lancashire on the world rock and roll map.
Yeah.
Bill Hart, this is the Lanky Beat Show, brought to you by Wrightington Hospital Radio. What a packed show we got for you tonight. I'm so excited. Golly Goulding, he'll be coming down. He's currently a guitarist with a band called the Paul Hayes Collection. And if you've heard the words Paul and Hayes put together, you might know him from Cashy on the Attic. And that's where Golly is playing with the band at the moment. And he'll be joining us a little bit later on, together with Pete Skip Holroyd. He's going to come down and tell of his life and times, backing a very famous singer that we all know, the only one and only Marty Wilde. So, with one or two other guests that might be popping in, and we've heard that the Mayor of Lancaster and Morecambe 2011 will be here, a guy called Paul Woodruff. Looking forward to meeting him too. But meanwhile, this is what it is called rock and roll. Wes Paul, the Wes Paul Band. What a great band they are too. They were down at Lanky Cats the other night and we had to put them on at the on the last spot. Now the last spot's tending to be a little bit, not a graveyard spot, but people start leaving about 10 to 11 and to put someone on at 10:30 and then get people walking out, it's a little bit iffy, isn't it? But we need to address things like that down at Lanky Cats and I'm sure Diane and I, when we get together, Diane is my producer, incidentally, and looking after me as usual. And down at Lanky Cats, Diane does the sound system down there as well. And looking at 10:45-ish, Every time we meet, we're always looking around at each other, wondering, hoping rather than wondering, hoping that not too many people will be up and leaving. Well, these guys came on and nobody left till 11:30. That is testimony unto itself. So that's the Wes Paul Band shaking all over. Shazam is a duo born from Johnny D and the Detours from Bolton. And this is Running Bear.
Way out west in Dakota runs the mighty Missouri River. On one side, the Apaches. On the other, the Blackfeet. To the thunder of drums, the two tribes make ready for war.
I'm learning all the time.
On the bank of the river stood Running Bear, young Indian brave.
On the other side of the river stood his lovely Indian maid.
Little white dove was her name. Such a lovely sight to see. But the tribes fought with each other, so the love could never be. Running Bear, love with the white dove, with a love big as the sky. Running Bear, love with the white dove, with a love that couldn't die. He couldn't swim the raging river, 'cause the river was too wide. He couldn't reach
that's
little white dove waiting on the other side. In the moonlight he could see her throwing kisses across the waves. Her little heart was beating faster,
strange.
Waiting there for her brave Running Bear,
running
bear. Little white dove, the sky. Running Bear, love little white dove, with a love that could die. Running Bear, dove in the water, little white dove did the same. And they swam out to each other, through the swirling stream they came. As their hands touched and their lips met, the raging river pulled them down. Now they'll always be together in the happy hunting ground. Running Bear, love little white dove, with a love big as the sky. Running Bear, love little white dove, with a love that couldn't die. Running Bear, love little white dove, with a love big as the sky. Running Bear, love little white dove, with a love that couldn't die. With a love that couldn't die. With a love that couldn't die.
Johnny D and the Detours. That was the guys and gals from the duo of Shazam. They're going round and doing the duo bit now. Johnny D and the Detours, I believe, are getting together and they're going to put a little package of live stuff and bringing it down to Lanky Cats in the new year. What about that? That's terrific news that I'm told from Fred Holt. So if you're listening, Fred, come on, get it on and get down to Lanky Cats as fast as you can. Okay, the 60s gems, always my favourite. Here it is, Shout.
You know you make me wanna shout. Look, my hands jumping. Shout. Look, my heart's thumping. Shout. Throw my hair back. Shout. Come on.
60s.
Make me wanna shout.
'60s gems from Accrington. Lead singer Natasha Harper, tremendous voice, huh? And a band I'm looking for to come down to and visit Lanky Cats pretty soon. They'll set the world on fire if they come to Lanky Cats, I can tell you. And what a tremendous voice does Natasha she got. Okay, several inquiries are being made at Lanky Cats for bands to turn up and play. I have kind of an offer on the table, as it were, that bands can just turn up on the night, show up with the guitars, pair of drumsticks. I'll fix them up with a slot, and away you go. Now, if you want to do that, fantastic. Alternatively, you can always give me a ring, 08450 94 87 95. That's 08450 94 87 95. Or email me at bill@lankybeat.com. That's bill@lankybeat.com. And don't forget the K in there, lankybeat.com. And we'll get you fixed up with a slot sometime early in the new year. And if you fancy it, you can just roll up on the night and away we go. We'll find you a slot. I'm always intrigued by who might just walk through that door. And one such band that walked through the door was Wes Paul, who we heard from earlier on with the Shaking All Over. They turned up at 10:30 one night. And we're always ready to just put you on and ready to get you to play. And don't forget the style of your music. You might not think Lanky Cats is for you in your style of music. I say rock and roll, you might say blues. You might say country music, I might say rap music. You know, we go for any particular style of music. As long as you can entertain an audience, you'll be entertained by our audience. They love live music. And come and get the Lanky Beat experience. Meanwhile, away we go. Thank you. Shims. A track from their CD, they made it in 19. What am I talking about? No, that was 2004, of course. And in 1960s, when they were tripping around the Wigan area and all over Lancashire, they never even heard of a song called Brown Eyed Girl, but they know the guy who actually wrote the song, Van Morrison, and they used to cover the song Gloria, remember that? G-L-O-R-I-A, Gloria. That Van Morrison song was a very, very popular hit at the time, especially with the bands going and doing the circuit. I love playing that. We had two versions going on the same kind of session with that in the 60s, and I really enjoyed playing that. And that's me on drums, folks, as well, doing the fancy bits, the twiddly bits there in the in-between time. And I must say, I did really enjoy the 60s, and it was unprecedented in its all of its glory in those days. I just revelled in the fact that I was playing in a band and I was going all over the country, east to west, north to south, up and down that M6, even before the M6 was finished. We were doing that down in Birmingham area. We were all across the way to Anglesey. We were up north to Barrow-in-Furness and over on the east coast to Sea Houses, places like that. Places, in other words, places you'd never see unless you kind of were with a band. You'd never go to a place called Sea Houses, at least where's I wouldn't have ever heard of a place called Caesar. But in the 60s, it was a six-hour drive to somewhere like that, and we used to go to places like that, over on Anglesey too, and taking us to places that, like I say, we wouldn't otherwise go. And this is where I want to take you now, which is a nice lead-in, because Jerry Sandon, who's a marvellous guitarist, who I'm hoping to catch up with later here in the studio, he's done a little song called Atlantis. Thank you. Okay, Atlantis by Jerry Sandon, obviously a cover by Jerry there of the Shadows' famous hit from the 60s. Donna Ettles is Jerry Sandon's daughter, and she wants to stand by your man.
Sometimes it's hard to be a woman, giving all your love to just one man. You'll have bad times, and he'll have good times, doing things that you don't understand. But if you love him, you forgive him, even though he's hard to understand. Man, stand by your man, give him two arms to cling to, and something warm to come to when nights are cold and lonely.
They don't come better than that, do they? I can't believe it. We're just discussing that with Diane here, and we both agree. Marvellous, marvellous Lanky talent that we've got. So we're so lucky to have people like that and in and around us. And Diane mentioned something and said, you know, why don't we hear of people like this a bit more? And I said, well, it's up to programmes like this that we're doing on Writington Hospital Radio, that we can put this together for them and put the songs out to you, the people, to listen to them and enjoy what we've just enjoyed. We think it's amazing. And this guy too, coming up next, Rod Demick. Rod was a member of a band called The Wheels, and just an earlier little chat I had with you before about the fact that this band covered a song called Gloria, written by Van Morrison, way back in the 60s, and they went down to London to the recording studio, which you did in those days. You have to go down to London to record your tracks down in those days. Not anymore, but that was how it was done. And they went down and recorded Gloria, and they were hoping to get a big hit with that. Anyway, the hit was actually made by Van Morrison, as we all know, and but they were the ones to cover it. And I remember being up playing on the bill with The Wheels, and The Wheels were from Belfast originally, and they settled down in Blackpool. They made Blackpool the base, so they're not really a Lanky band as such, but such was their impact in the area, and they came over in the early 60s with their style of rhythm and blues, particularly the blues, the gritty side of rock and roll, began to emerge. And they were one of the leaders in that particular genre, if you like, of rock and roll music. And we played at the Court Hall in Wigan on King Street one night, and we got relegated to second band because he used to put two bands on the night, so he had to share the night. And whoever turned up first on the night got to go on first. So you'd a little bit of shenanigans used to go on with that. The vans used to kind of ride around the block and look for the other van to be if it was being unloaded. They knew they were going on first. But if there was no van there and you had your van and you went in first, you knew you were going on first. So there was this little bit of to-ing and fro-ing that used to go on because nobody wanted to really go on first. Don't know why. Anyway, we just got on with it, humped all the gear in first, and then next thing the Wheels came along with their band, and they set up. And we sang Gloria in those days as well. And what happened then? We came off stage having made a good job of all the set. We thought we'd done a good job, and we did. We'd done Gloria. And one of the guys from the Wheels, name I won't mention, he was waiting for us in the dressing room, and he tore a strip off us and said, "It's the worst version of Gloria I've ever heard in my life," in an Irish accent, which, of course, we'd never heard anybody talk to us like that before. He was absolutely livid. And he had a bald head as well, which was unusual in those days as well. So there's a little story for you. And this guy, Rod Demick, he was in the Wheels, and he says, "Baby, please, don't go." Demick, the Wheels, "Baby, Please Don't Go." That's his cool version there. Rod's still doing the pubs down in the Cumbria area and the Southern Lakes there. You'll if you ever get round to popping in pubs around there, you'll find him doing his business and doing it very well. Sometimes solo, sometimes with a duo. and he'll be he's an amazing entertainer, and I suggest if you're ever up that way, give him you know, look out for him and just see if you can spot him doing Baby Please Don't Go. This is Foot on the Brake, Atlanta Roots.
Say you're starving when you're eating all our lies.
Is there anybody out there who ain't on the bed? Is there anybody out there who ain't on the take? Won't somebody come and put their foot on the brake? Oh no, is there anybody out there who ain't on the bed? Is there anybody out there? Love the medicine. Won't somebody come and put? Somebody come and put.
Wow.
Somebody come and put their foot on the.
Live. Recorded at Radio Lancashire. That's where you're a producer as well, Diane. And you've spent some happy hours up there of late, and I believe you're moving on a little from Radio Lancashire.
Having a break.
Yeah, you're having a break, that's what they call it. Atlanta roots, well rooted in the 60s, these guys, and I've just got hold of that CD, done live, like I say, at Radio Lancashire, and I was pretty impressed of the how tight that particular track is, and four others I've got, and I'm going to play them as well over the next few weeks. But meanwhile, 57 Chevy from Leyland, here we go, Heartbreak Hotel.
Since my baby left me, well, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street at Heartbreak Hotel, where I'll be. I'll be so lonely, baby. Well, I am so lonely. I'll be so lonely, I could die. Oh, though it's always crowded, you still can find some room for broken-hearted lovers to cry there in the gloom. They'll be so lonely, so lonely, baby. They're so lonely. They'll be so lonely, they could die. Now the bell of tears keep flowing, the desk clerk's dressed in black. Well, it's been so long on Lonely Street, they'll never look back. And so, well, they're so lonely, baby. Well, they're so lonely. They'll be so lonely, they could die. Well, now, if your baby leaves ya, you've got a tale to tell. Just take a walk down Lonely Street to Heartbreak Hotel, where you will be. You'll be so lonely, baby. You'll be so lonely. You'll be so lonely, you could die. For broken-hearted lovers to cry there in the gloom. They'll be so lonely, baby. Well, they're so lonely. They'll be so lonely, they could die.
'57 Chevy, Heartbreak Hotel. Love that particular version. When they came to Lanky Cats, they didn't play that, but when they do at sometime in the future, we must get them to have a little go at that, because that's one of my favourite Elvis tunes of all time. In other words, just pre-60s, Elvis was churning stuff like that out like nobody's business, and everybody was getting their socks off to that, I can tell you. Hey, so are we going to get our socks off in a few weeks' time, Diane? Because Wrightington Hospital Radio are having a shindig, and they're going to be putting together a charity night. We're going to raise some money, hopefully, for the radio station. We've had to move premises, and when you're moving, it costs money to move. And if you've ever moved house, you'll know what I mean. You try moving a studio. And that's what we've got to do. We've got to find a new premises, which we believe we've found the new kind of premises within the hospital grounds. And we are now in the process of thinking about the move over to the new premises. So we need some money in order to do it. And we've been doing great so far. And we believe we've got just enough to kind of carry the thing off and get established in the new studio, which we're all looking forward to. But meanwhile, what we've got going on for you is the hospital radio will be running Rock and Roll on the 7th of December, which I think is a Friday night. Am I right, Diane? Friday the 7th of December. St. James's Roman Catholic Club, Oral, near Wigan. We're going to have the Blue Notes. They're going to have Vintage. And there are going to be one or two surprises. Get a fiver out of your pocket, stick it in our purses, okay, when you get there, and we're going to have a rock and roll night. Okay, that's that then. That's the adverts over with. Well,
she comes up like a rose. But everybody knows she got you in dutch. Well, you can look, but you better not touch. Poison ivy, poison ivy. Late at night while you're sleeping, poison ivy comes a creeping around. She's pretty as a daisy, but look at me, she's crazy. She'll really do you in. Poison ivy, poison ivy. Let it matter while you're sleeping, poison ivy comes a creeping around.
Knees will make you mobby, mumps will make you lobby, chicken pox will make you jump and twitch. A common cold will fool ya, and whooping cough can cool ya.
Poison ivy, Lord, will make you itch.
Of calamine lotion, you'll be scratching like a hound
the minute that you start to mess around.
Poison ivy, poison ivy.
Let it matter while you're sleeping, poison ivy comes to creep you down the ground.
Measles will make you mumpy, mumps will make you mumpy. Chicken pox will make you jump and twitch. A common cold will fool ya, and whooping cough will cool ya.
Poison ivy, Lord, will make you itch.
You're gonna need a notion of calamine lotion. You'll be scratching like a hound
the minute that you start to mess around.
Poison ivy.
That's the Friends, and they were on Lanky Beat Show several weeks ago with Mitch and Mick, producing some lovely little sounds there. Well, right now, ladies and gentlemen, we've got in the studio, after a load of kerfuffle and wrong turnings and down the wrong streets, we've got our guests of the evening. They've just arrived. We'll just say a quick hello. And sat right at the side of me, we've got Golly Goulding. And say hello, Golly.
Hello, folks.
And we'll, and just over on the other side of the studio, I hope we can hear him loud and clear, is Peter Skip Holroyd. Hi, Pete.
Hello there.
Do you want me to call you Pete or Skip?
Call me Skip. Everybody else.
Everybody
does.
Else does. Where did that come from, Skip? Where did where did your nickname come from?
I emigrated to Australia when I was a teenager.
Right. Oh, Skip, as in Skippy. Yeah. Oh, I thought it was more rock and roll than that.
No, I'm afraid.
No, it was. It wasn't quite as I thought. Yeah.
No.
So you came back from Australia. I want to take you back before you even went to Australia. I want to take you back to when you were perhaps in school, in short pants, and wondering about the rest of your life and what you were going to do with it. Although we didn't do things like that now in those days, we just got on with it. But blaring out on the steam radio, you used to listen to Radio Luxembourg like I did, I'm sure you did. And what kind of things influenced you at the time to get you moving into rock and roll as you know it and we know it now?
Well, mainly the Beatles were the band of the day when I was growing up as a young teenager.
Yeah.
And they were just my favourite band and probably still are.
Yeah, yeah. And you're from Darwin, aren't you?
Well, I live in Darwin.
You live in Darwin?
Yeah.
You're not from Darwin, then?
No, I was born in Burnley.
Burnley. And I know one night the Beatles turned up in several places around your area, didn't they?
They turned up in Darwin. We're talking about that.
Yeah.
Coming over.
Yeah.
There's a ticket.
Was it the Co-op Hall?
The Co-op Hall, yeah.
That no longer exists?
No, that's gone now.
And
Where else did they play around that area?
Well, one little story I know about that particular evening when the Beatles were at the Co-op Hall.
Yeah.
A friend of mine, Jim Hotwood, who I've played in several bands with over the years.
I've heard that name, Jim Hotwood.
He was in a band called the Electones.
That's right, yeah.
And he was supporting the Beatles.
Yeah.
And at some point in the evening, they were a bit hungry, and he took them to the local chip shop.
Right.
To obviously feed them and
sample the chippies.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, it's a gourmet centre of the universe for me, Darwin.
It is, yeah.
Because I love my pies, being a Wiganer.
Yeah.
And I got a shock of my life because I got married about 10 years ago to a young lady called Christine, and she has her roots in the Blackburn area, but and then moved into Darwin and introduced me to the delights of the gourmet restaurants and pie shops.
Oh, yeah,
of Darwin.
It's the Indians that are famous.
I know, and it's fantastic. And being a Wiganer, I thought we were the centre of the universe for pies, but I know we're not now, because Darwin is.
No, no.
Because I was introduced one night to a thing called a pea pie. Now, that's a showstopper, isn't it? Mushy peas inside a pie. And I thought, I'll have half of one. And, you know, I've never been the same since.
No.
Honest to God, it was a kind of a bit Marmite experience. Love it and hate it. I'm supposed to love it because it's a pie, but then mushy peas. Oh, well, we won't go into it.
No.
But anyway, I digress, as I tend to do. But there you go. So, Skip, take us back then. The Beatles are your main influence. So, what did you do about it?
My dad was a musician, he played keyboards.
Right.
In a sort of dance band at the time, and he bought me a guitar, went for guitar lessons, and didn't do very well because the chap that was teaching me knew that I wasn't actually reading the dots. I was busking, you know, I'd learnt it in my head, and I wasn't following the music, so I used to get a clout round the head.
You were cheating.
Yeah.
Yep.
so I left that, and my dad was always looking for a bass player. He could never find a bass player for his band. So he said, I'm going to buy you a bass.
Yep.
And he used to play pedals, the bass pedals on the organ.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
So he actually taught me to play bass from the pedals.
Yeah.
And that's how I got into playing bass. Yeah. I was probably about 14, playing in a dance band in my short pants.
Yeah. You know. How old would you be?
14.
14?
Yeah.
That's early to start, isn't it?
So it was a good grounding.
Did you have a full-size bass guitar? I mean, the physical size of a bass guitar.
It was a full-size. I can tell you what make it was. It was a Burns Trisonic, which was quite a small body.
I'm impressed.
Yeah.
I've never heard of one of them before.
No.
Yeah.
You look that up. It's a small-bodied one.
I know. Fantastic. And so you were doing that, and were you doing any performing around that time? I mean...
With my father, I was, yeah.
Yeah.
We played in a working men's club.
Right.
Yeah.
As a what? A kind of a trio, a duo?
There was, it used to vary. We'd have a sax player or a trombone player.
Yeah. What kind of material were you playing? What sort of music was it?
It was dance music, as in waltzes and
foxtrots
and foxtrots and all that sort of stuff,
right.
Yeah.
So your grounding then was, that's a pretty good grounding.
Yeah, yeah.
Because latterly, when I played drums, it was always to the Shadows and stuff like that, and then latterly getting onto the Beatles.
Mm.
And then when I went on into the 70s and went into the clubs, I started to learn dance music, and I wished I'd have learned dance music before I became a rock drummer.
Yeah.
Because it teaches you all those rhythms, doesn't it?
Yeah.
That stand you in good stead for later in life.
But I didn't like it at the time, because obviously at that age you want to be a pop star, you don't want to be in a dance band, you know, so...
Yeah.
I stuck it for a little while, then joined a band, and that was it from there.
Right. Tell me about the band that you joined then.
The first band was called The Trap.
The Trap?
The Trap. Mm. And that was 1968-ish.
Ish,
yeah.
Yep. So we're getting late on in the 60s before you were cutting your teeth then, in this business.
Yeah.
Merseybeat had peaked in, I would say, 65, 66.
Yes.
So and it was changing dramatically then, the musical style, into more blues-orientated, heavy rock started to emerge, didn't it, with the heavy rock bands of the early 70s. So where did you sit in all that?
We sat doing we'd gone down the Tamla Motown route.
That's right, yeah.
That sort of feel to the band, you know.
Yeah.
But again, that band didn't last too long.
As they
didn't in them days, did they?
Yeah. They're always switching and jockeying, weren't they? Musicians trying to find other like-minded musicians, falling out with existing musicians. We all went through that, didn't we? Moving on from the trap, what happened kind of after that?
Then I joined the Midnight Hour, which are featured in Lanky Beach somewhere as a picture of
that's them right there. Yeah, I remember that. I remember you sending it to me. Yeah.
And they were quite a successful semi-pro band at the time, working 5-6 nights a week.
Right. Doing what kind of venues were you doing?
We had a Blackpool agent at the time, so mainly over the Blackpool end.
And there like was on the prom, doing pubs and clubs.
Yeah, that sort of thing. Yeah. All the youth clubs
to holiday makers.
Yeah, youth clubs as well were quite...
Oh, right, yeah.
You know, quite...
did you ever go on the Winter Gardens and places like that?
I have played at the Winter Gardens, but that was much later.
Much later on.
Yeah.
Well, take us through then to that much later on. We'll just leave that for a minute, because I want to play one of your tracks. If you'll explain to our wonderful listeners out there, you know, that... you're sat at the side of Kathy, and Kathy and yourself. They do, you do, a duo, don't you, around the local circuit.
Yeah.
And you've made, put together a special CD, I take it, that you brought along with you. And is this yourself and Kathy?
This is our band. We have a band as well.
You have a band as well? So it's all live?
It's all live. Kathy singing, I play bass and keyboards.
Yeah.
My son's the drummer.
Fantastic.
And we have a young guy called Danny who plays guitar and sings.
So that's up to date, Sif. And the title of this particular track?
The Chain.
Listen to the wind blow.
find out a little bit more about what he was doing shortly after his two bands that got him going out of the clubs and dance venues that he's just been explaining to us about. We moved from there onto the trap and then onto the Midnight Hour. And how was it going by this time? Were you settled with the Midnight Hour, or did you move on again?
I was settled with them for a while, and then an opportunity came to go and work with Marty Wilde. From the drummer with Marty Wilde was watching our band in a pub,
right,
in Blackburn.
Yeah,
and they wanted a bass player quickly.
Yeah,
so I had to make a decision there and then whether to go with them or not.
Right.
I took the decision.
Had you family commitments at the time?
No, I was only 17.
17. And you were asked by who, and we're 17-year-old, Marty Wilde asked you at 17 years old to go and play with him.
Yeah.
And did you hesitate for more than a nanosecond?
No, not really. No. Not
I
at
can
that
imagine,
age,
yeah.
I jumped at it, yeah.
I bet you did. Fantastic. I mean, that's amazing stuff. And what about the band that backed Marty Wilde?
Right. Well,
who was that?
They're featured quite a lot in Lankybeat. They were called The Weather.
Yeah, yeah.
And there were quite a few different.
They were the Electones.
Yeah.
Then they were the Summers. Now this is off the top of my head.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm a Lankybeat nerd, me. Yeah. And I know these things. And then on they went to become Weather. Now,
yeah.
I don't know. Did they call themselves The Weather or Weather?
The Weather.
The Weather. Right.
And that sort of fizzled out. One or two of the members left, and they were back in Marty Wilde at the time, and the bass player left. I got the opportunity to join, and was with him for around about 18 months.
Yeah.
Before a couple of the lads decided they wanted to leave.
Yeah.
And do something else.
Things, things move on again. But taking you obviously back into the Marty Wilde era, and you know, whereabouts were was the band taking you now by this time? Where were you playing?
All over the country.
Yeah.
Then we got.
So you were a pro band.
Pro band, yeah.
Backing up a mega.
More or less 7 nights a week,
singer.
Every week, yeah.
Yeah.
And then we did some travelling abroad. We did the CSC tours for the troops. Out in the Far East and Gibraltar, Germany, wherever the troops were.
I've got a cracking picture on Lankybeat of Marty Wilde and you guys with the Rock of Gibraltar behind you.
That's a picture I sent in.
Fantastic picture that's on Lankybeat. And if you, by the way, if you like to check in to the Lankybeat website, www.lankybeat.com. Don't forget the K, LANKY, beat, BAT.com, and have a look at the Weather webpage. And I think you might find it also under the Electones webpage and maybe the Summers. So either of them, scroll down the index and find the Weather or Weather, because it'll be under W, and click on and have a look at a cracking picture. These guys with backing up Marty Wilde, with others as well. Good old-fashioned black and white pictures in there too, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so you found yourself there, traipsing all over the place, all over Europe, playing a bass guitar, and you were barely, what, how old?
17, when we went to Bahrain.
You weren't old enough to go into a pub here, were you?
I wasn't really old enough to get in the country and work. Because they weren't going to let me in at first.
Yeah.
Because of my age, when we got to Bahrain, and they did some talking, and then they let me in eventually.
Right.
So.
Because of your age, only because of your age. Mm. Yeah. What about parental consent? You needed even parental consent to get married those days, didn't you, as well?
Yeah,
I mean, they
no
had to sign forms for you, didn't they?
Yeah, no problem with that. They were dead keen on me doing it, yeah.
It's something you never think about, is it, when you travel abroad? You just go abroad and you just take your passport, don't you?
Yeah.
It was a bit different those days, wasn't it? It's borders weren't open like that.
No,
I remember crossing borders, like from, we had to go from, we went into Belgium, then went into Germany, then we went into Italy, and at each one border, you had to stop and be searched.
Yeah.
And going on at one of the border points,
the guards came on, armed, looking for tea. Tea leaves or what have you. That. Now, that baffled me to this day, but there you go. That's another way. I drift off, folks. You'll have to bear with me. I drift away. The thing. But getting back to you, Skip, must have been a thrill and a half.
Somebody
like Marty Wilde. What kind of a guy is Marty Wilde?
Fabulous guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, really nice guy.
Yeah, he's still doing it.
Yeah.
I've noticed in my local paper, I live in Southport, and we get the local papers, you know, is what's coming on at Southport Theatre. I'm not giving them a plug, by the way, but, you know, we get all these guys coming along, and Marty Wilde, I believe, is scheduled to come to Southport Theatre.
Yeah, and
soon.
I believe he's still really, really good.
Yeah, excellent, yeah. Excellent. I mean, if you knocked on his dressing room door, I mean, would you, do you think he'd say, I Skip?
He did. He came to Blackburn not so long ago, and we were working that night, so we couldn't go and see him. But apparently he made references to the Blackburn, us, you know, the Blackburn lads. So he obviously still remembers us.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, it's something you never forget. I think your bandmates and all that. You might forget the names even, but you'll not forget the face.
No.
Because you get very close and tight with your bandmates, don't you?
You do.
I mean, you've got this common cause of going out on that stage, and you don't want to go down badly. You don't want to go down well. And it tightens you up no end and gives you this camaraderie, doesn't it? That, well, it's just you just can't kind of define it, can you?
No.
What it is, that magic on stage. And when you hit it and it's going well, you just know, don't you? And what a boom that is, you know?
Yeah.
It's fantastic, fantastic stuff, you know? That's one of the reasons I got Lanky Cats going, because I missed the live show. My band packed in about 3 years ago. We were doing this. We were doing very well until recession kicked in and clubs couldn't afford us anymore. Preferred the duo setup, and you know, which was a lot cheaper than four live musicians. Mm-hmm. And we had to kind of pack it in. So Lanky Cats got together for that very reason. And, you know, so I could have a knock. I'm not bothered about getting paid. I just get that buzz back into my life a little bit, and that's what happens every now and again when I get down there and get behind my kit. You know, it's fantastic. So just think on, if you ever want, you know, well, you're more than welcome to come down and
When we can get everybody together, get
something together.
Yeah.
And love to see you both of you performing, you as well, Kathy, and get you on that stage and give you half an hour, and we'll have a good time, as they say here in Lancashire.
Yeah.
Now then, you've got a second track for us, and if you talk us through that, what's this second track all about?
This is the band The Chain again, and it's a song that, it's not really our thing, really, is it, this song that we do? It's the guitar player heard this song, he's only a young lad, he's not like us.
Yep.
He heard this song, he said, what a great song I've heard. And I listened to it, and I said, it's Cliff Richards, that. It's not...
Yeah.
It's not...
It's a Cliff Richards style.
Yeah.
Yeah, but not a Cliff Richards song.
No, it's a Cliff Richards song.
Oh, is it?
So this is a Cliff Richards song, done our way.
On your way.
Yeah.
I like it.
But a friend, I have a picture, would you take it?
amazed, aren't we? We're all amazed. Lovely, lovely stuff. There's no question about it. I mean, that you should be very proud of that particular track. But tell us, you know, tell us what happened when you first played it in a pub.
It didn't go down well at all, that track. As soon as we mentioned the name Cliff Richards,
yeah,
the sort of pubs that we play with the band,
yeah,
because our band is more of a rocky type band,
hard rock, blues,
not so much hard rock, more soft rock, but rocky, and they just didn't get that track at all, so we don't do that anymore.
You don't do that anymore. No. What a shame! What a shame. So there weren't many Cliff Richard fans in that pub.
Not though. Really, no.
No, no. I can imagine. I know. You have to live and learn when you... Material in a band is a I find the most difficult
it
thing
is,
of the lot.
Yeah.
Finding the right material. Because if you hit the spot with the right song, crowds go absolutely amazed and absolutely berserk sometimes, don't they?
Yeah.
But if you hit the wrong song, you kind of... You may as well... They're paying you up and sending you on.
Yeah, you could be the best band in the world if you're not playing the right material for it.
Exactly. It's not an easy thing. So, take us through then to a little bit more kind of bringing us up to date at what happened with your next kind of stage of your musical life.
After the Marty Wilde thing, I answered an advert in the Manchester Evening News for a bass player, basically, and it was the Paper Dolls, if you remember them.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And I went and played with them for about 12 months.
Yeah.
And I also took Pete, who was a drummer with The Weather.
Yeah.
He came with us and he played with them as well.
Right.
But in the meantime, he was writing stuff.
Yeah.
And he wanted to get an original band together.
Yeah.
So we left the Paper Dolls. And we got some guys together to do some original material. We recorded in a studio in Bolton, near Bolton, and it was the Answers studio, if you remember the Answers.
I don't know it, no, personally.
They're featured in...
Right.
In Lankybeat, I'm sure.
Up there, right, yeah.
They had a little studio in there, and it was okay for a demo studio.
Yeah.
So we sent the material down to an agent in London, and he called for us to call down and record.
Yeah.
And he was the manager of Deep Purple, this guy.
Yeah.
And...
Do you remember his name?
No, but he sent Ian Paste from Deep Purple to produce.
Not a kind of a useful drummer he was, didn't he? I mean, Ian Paste was a drummer. He's even got a range of cymbals named after him.
Yeah.
He? Being a drummer nerd, I know things like that.
Right. Yeah. But... The drummer that we had in the band, which Pete was a drummer, but he had such a great voice.
Oh, I remember Pete's voice in The Weather.
Yeah, he had such a
great... They did Beach Boys stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
They were the only band I know that actually went and did live stuff that was Beach Boys, five voice harmonies with all the falsettos, a lot, live, with like AC-30s. No big sound systems, but you want to. You should have heard that amazing sound that I heard back at Wigan Emp one Monday night. Mm. I'm there with my girlfriend, and again, I've never been same since I heard them guys singing five voice harmonies. It just
I'm the same as you because I saw them quite regular before I didn't even know them before I joined.
Yeah,
them.
Right.
I just went to go. I used to go and watch them.
Yeah,
and but going back to the. Going in the studio in London, we got a drummer by the name of Paul Burgess.
Oh, know him well. 10cc?
10cc's drummer.
Yeah, yeah. And we played a track just before you arrived from a band called Atlanta Roots.
Yeah.
And he guested on some of the tracks.
Yeah.
Now, that particular one, I do know, it was Paul Burgess playing on that particular track I played tonight earlier.
Well, we went to watch 10cc a couple of weeks ago. He got his tickets.
And who was in the audience as well? Diane. Did you producer go? Diane.
Was it at Halifax?
No, I was at Southport
Theatre. Theatre.
We went to Halifax.
You went to Halifax, there you go.
But, yeah, great band.
Oh, yeah.
Great band.
So...
So anyway, we didn't we went into the management offices the day after with the tapes, and he played the tapes and basically didn't like them, and that was it.
Yeah. Can you give me a flavour of the material that you were writing at the time?
It was very progressive.
Yeah.
It was very progressive, yeah.
Yeah.
It was, because it was Deep Purple's management, they sort of...
And there was no more progressive band than Deep Purple pushing that stuff.
Yeah.
That they were, yeah, I mean, but, they were breaking new ground with their material, weren't they?
But we later found out that the reason why they sent for us to go down is they wanted Pete to join Deep Purple.
Really?
Mm. And if you look on Pete's website, Pete has a website, Pete Taylor.
Yeah.
He tells a little bit of a story about that.
I will do that.
Mm.
That's Pete Taylor's website.
Yeah.
I'll probably Google it and then
You'll
the
find
www.
Him, yeah.
Dot.
He's in South Africa now.
And I believe so. And he comes home now and again, doesn't he?
Yeah.
And they all have one almighty booze up, I believe.
We have had that.
Yes, I believe so. I've heard about them. Yeah, they were in, I think they were in Darwin Reporter or something like that last time he came home. I know you have, I know you do get a good get together.
We do, yeah.
It's Barry Lanson, who's the lead singer in The Weather,
I'm
in touch with. And is it Pete Eddleston?
Pete, the bass player.
And they come down to Lanky Cats and with the original rock and roll band, they call in themselves.
Mm.
Yeah, they come down. They're due to come down pretty soon as well.
Right.
Oh, that's great. That's great stuff. So, tell me what else you're doing besides, you're performing then, Skip. What kind of things are you doing? Like, for instance, tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock when you get up, what will you be doing?
Getting ready for work, going to open our shop. That's a little plug for the shop there.
You got a shop?
Yeah.
What's your shop called?
It's called Q-Music.
And where would I find Q-Music?
183 Duckworth Street, Darwin.
Right, and what would I find inside your shop?
Guitars, amps, drum kits.
So you're doing the musical side of things?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Anything else you do? Have you got a studio?
We did have a studio upstairs from the shop, but we've found better use for the rooms upstairs, i.e.
right.
teaching.
Teaching, things like that?
Yeah, guitar teaching, yeah.
You do that teaching?
Not personally, we have a teacher that comes in.
You have a teacher that comes in. And what about repairs and things like that? I mean, that's always
We do repairs. We have a guy that comes in and repairs amps. Specialists in valve stuff.
Right, yeah. What about guitars, broken guitars and things
like that? Yeah, we can do that.
You do that as well?
We set up guitars. If we can't repair them, we'll send them to somebody who can.
Right, so you do your best to kind of do all the things. Well, that's very, very interesting stuff for people like me who, work in Lanky Cats. We have our own gear.
Mm.
And, of course, gear gets broken, wears out and what have you. And I'm going to be needing somebody like you to help me out now and again. And I do need a new drum stool. That's something we need. So we'll come to you for that.
We can find you one of them, I think.
We'll start the purchase ball rolling. I want a drum stool. Find me a good drum stool.
We'll do that.
And to go with our nice drum kit that we've got there. Well, it's been great, great talking to you. I don't want you to go away. I want you to just stay there. But because I know we have got another track left, and then after that track, I'm waiting very patiently, sat right at the side of me, is Golly Goulding, and I'm sure we're going to find life a lot interesting as well as Skip. We'll take a little break and give you this particular song of The Chain.
amazing track from a band originally doing that song was Supertramp, wasn't it? Skip that.
Yep.
Complimentary compliments all the way around to you. Kathy, that's your voice, isn't it? Oh, she's nodding. She won't say anything, but she will just say a big, big thank you to Kathy for contributing to Lanky Beat, the Lanky Beat show. I'm kind of blown away about the immense talent that we have. It's kind of undiscovered in a way, because it belongs in Lancashire, but doesn't seem to get outside its borders at all. And I'm hoping that that's what the Lanky Beat show is going to do. And eventually, we're going to get some recognition for all this talent that we have in Lancashire. Because we've lived in the shadows, Diane, for so long, haven't we? The shadows of the River Mersey, I think we've lived in, haven't we? And we're out of the darkness and into the light. Oh. Right, okay. Golly. That's who I've got next. Golly Goulding. And he said hello earlier. Now I'm going to give him a chance to put his little story forward. And I can't imagine it's going to be small, though. And I want to just say to you, welcome, Golly, to the Lanky Beat show. And thank you for travelling all that way, because you've come down from Morecambe, I believe.
Yep.
And tell us all about your life and times that when you got going in that part of the world of Lancashire.
Where do you want me to start, Bill?
I know. Churchill used to say that, you know.
Yeah.
Where would you like me to start?
How far back do you want to go?
Yeah. Well, let's put you in short pants, get you running around that schoolyard. And see, you know, you come home, your tea was on the table, and your mum and your dad would be in, and then you'd switch the radio on. And what would you be listening to?
Well, I wasn't listening to any radio in them days, Bill, because there was nothing to listen to. But our next-door neighbours got a television round about 1955.
Yeah.
And I went in. I used to go in all the time. To my next door neighbours, my Auntie Doris, and the TV was on, and it was 6-5 special, and I saw Tommy Steele,
yep,
playing a guitar and singing. I've never even knew what a guitar was.
Little White
was.
Bull?
No, way before that. Little White Bull was one of the last ones. Like Rock with a Caveman, I think it was.
Oh,
I mean, vintage stuff, Bill, you know. Yeah. You're talking
55, 56.
Yeah.
Well, let's face it, that's when it began, really, isn't it?
I was about 8 or 9. I think I was probably about 9.
Yeah, yeah.
And I saw this lad with a guitar singing, dancing about. I thought, bloody hell, this is what I want to do.
Yeah.
And I was hooked. I'd never seen a guitar. I'd never heard of a guitar. I didn't know what it was.
Yeah.
And that's what got me going.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Just a 6-string guitar?
No. It was a 4-string guitar.
4-string?
Anyway, Tommy Steele started to get popular. He was like the number one.
He certainly was.
Yeah. And they built a little plastic guitar called the Tommy Steele guitar, and it was in the toy shops, and it was 24 and 11.
24 and
25 shilling almost by a penny.
Let's put that in today's money, £1.25.
Yeah.
What can you buy for £1.25 these days? You can't buy a bottle of milk for that, can you?
No, but you can buy a Tommy Steele guitar. I've seen it. There's only one. I've seen it on the internet.
Yeah.
It's just under 500 quid.
Yeah. Yeah. What a collector's item.
Yeah. And that's how I started,
yeah.
Bill. Christmas present, little 4-string guitar.
1955-ish?
56. And then a year after, in the papers, they were advertising another Tommy Steele guitar, which was a slightly bigger model, 4-string again, and I got that for me, probably my 10th Christmas present.
Right.
And then after that, excuse me, Spanish guitar.
Yeah.
Going up 6 strings then.
Yeah.
We're going through to about 1959.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, what is it that brings you and an instrument together? What a person, any person and an instrument together
For me, I clapped eyes on a snare drum in the Boys' Brigade at 12 years old. And I'd heard the bands walking down the street, Walking Days. And I didn't remember so much as hearing it, as feeling it. You felt something that hit you in your solar plexus.
Yeah.
When you heard the bands play. Pipe bands, brass bands, you learn it.
Yeah.
It's something that hits you here. And it's indescribable, but you know it's a lovely feeling.
Yeah.
And is that what you can relate to, in a way, when you get your instrument of a guitar and putting that person, you, together with an instrument? Did you get that buzz straight away?
Of course I did, yeah. That's all I ever wanted to do. School never meant anything to me. Sport never meant anything to me.
Yeah.
It was just guitar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what did you do about it then? Just your academic studies, you weren't too happy about? No. You left school, then what?
Well, I was in the Army Cadets from about 13 to 14. And when we were in the cadets, that was one of my mates wanted to play drums, another one wanted to sing. So we left school in 62, and we've been talking about forming a group for about 2 years before that. So as soon as we left school, we all went and got instruments, you know.
But the Tommy Steele influence had really waned by this time, hadn't it? So what was in its place that was inspiring you now?
In its place was Cliff Richard and the Shadders.
Yeah.
I got all my hand up, it was. Rick Nelson, of course.
Yeah.
But
the American influence, that
I got to be honest about it, Bill. It was more the British stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
really was.
Elvis, Chuck Berry, Jerry Lee Lewis, all doing that business in America, flogging the records over here in the millions, us buying them, you know, and then all of a sudden we had Cliff Richard and the Shadows, didn't we?
Yeah.
That was some kind of rival to that.
Yeah.
And it was that inspired you.
Yeah.
I must admit it was too, mate.
Yeah, yeah.
I went for Cliff Richard and the Shadows.
I did
big
myself, Bill, yeah.
Yeah.
And every time a Shadows number was released, starting with Apache for me.
Yeah.
I had to learn it, you know.
Yeah.
I made myself learn it. And then I think after that it was FBI, I had to learn it, you know. And they seemed to be bringing a record out about every 3 or 4 months.
And your skills were improving all the time, weren't they, this progression? Yeah.
Well, I used to stop off school and sit at home and learn these bloody things, you know.
Yeah.
I owed it to myself. I had to do it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So as soon as we left school, Bill, we started in a group.
This passion that's going on.
Yeah.
And it's still there today.
It's still there, Bill. Yeah.
What? Yeah. I mean,
it really is, and I'm still playing. I'm still reasonably busy, and
I'm
still
so.
Getting a kick out of it.
Absolutely, I know. I only met you recently, and it was at Lanky Cats. It was over a year ago.
Yeah.
And we'll go back to that later. We'll talk about all that later. But you brought a few tracks with you. And the first one, it's going back to 1964, I believe. You take us through...
1964.
Yeah.
It's with a group called Meldine and the Leaders, who were a successful, very successful local group. The guitarist left to join the Foremost, Liverpool band.
Oh, yeah.
He left to join the Foremost. Oh. He then went on to play with Proby. And then went on to play with Tom Jones. Well, as soon as he left town, it left it wide open for me.
Fantastic.
And I jumped right into his boots.
Fantastic.
And joined this little band. I think the first track, is it Bad Boy? Yeah.
Okay.
All the people down the street who ever meet say I'm a bad boy. Say I'm a bad boy. Say I'm a bad boy. Even dear old dad, when he gets mad, says I'm a bad boy. Says I'm a bad boy. Says I'm a bad boy. Well, you see now I've got a girl, we stay out late almost every night. Yeah, the people just stare, they declare, girl,
Remarkably, that's a Marty Wilde track, isn't it? That's great. Gets us back to where Skip was saying that he was in a band called The Weather, backing who else but Marty Wilde. And that was a track made famous by him. And you covered that then, Golly?
Yeah.
Live,
yeah.
You say?
Yeah. Mel Dean, of course, the singer... I've got to say this, Bill.
Yeah.
He was certainly the best singer ever in our area, or ever likely to be.
Yes.
The boy was brilliant, yeah.
And you say in the past tense was...
He's still around, Bill, but he's not in good health.
No, no. Well, we'll wish him all the best.
Yeah, and, certainly. You know, yeah. I love him to bits, but...
Yeah, we've loved hearing you. Loved hearing the song there, Mel, and if you do manage to tune in, well, great. And just take care of yourself, and that's fantastic. Just, so, back to you, Golly. Whereabouts is the you and this music now progressing to, or does it go back a little bit? You know, take me to the next stage.
Well, can we step back a little bit before that? That was,
no
that was 1964, Bill.
Yeah.
Talking about 62... We started this band leaving school.
Yeah.
You know, all got with parents to go and sign HP. Got ourselves into debt and started playing. Started doing okay, you know. Doing the there wasn't a lot going on in pubs in them days. It was mainly like community centres, village halls, dance halls.
Yeah. Yeah, it was
not really much in pubs. Then pubs started, well, especially on the seafront in Morecambe.
Yeah,
they used to put groups on and
on the pier.
Yeah,
on the pier. But it was usually a dance
pier
was band, wasn't it? On the end of the pier.
That the pier at Morecambe
traditional. Yeah,
the pier at Morecambe had a dance band. You know, like a 16-piece dance band.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
And then they had Harold Graham came on. And played the big old theatre organ.
That's right.
You know, in between the the dance band.
Yeah.
But across the road, down the road half a mile, across the road was the floral hall, who had groups on.
Right.
Beat groups, as we call them in them
Absolutely.
Days.
Absolutely.
And in the summer, they had them on 7 nights a week and 7 days a week.
Incredible.
And that's when we started playing.
Under the name of?
Under the name, well, the first name was Jet Black and the Decorters, and then the Decorters came out with Billy J.
They were from Stockport, weren't they? Yeah. The Decorters.
Brilliant band, the Decorters.
Yeah.
Mike Maxfield on
still
guitar.
Still doing it, I believe.
Oh,
Still doing it.
Great band, or great group, as we used to call them. Anyway, so we changed the name, Bill, to the Fontaines.
Right. Jet Black and the Fontaines, or just Fontaines?
Jet Black and the Decorters changed to Tony and the Fontaines.
Tony and the Fontaines.
Yeah, yeah.
The good names, good old-fashioned names, these, aren't they? I mean, what it says about the personalities in the band, just choosing a name for a band. I mean, were you there when you chose the name for that band? Who kind of drove the you know, you sat round, right, we'll find a name for our band.
No, it was an easy one.
Was it?
It was an easy one.
Tell us how it
came. I'll tell you how easy it was.
Go on.
Because our drummer, Mick, he worked with a fella at a mill in Lancashire. Lancashire had a couple of cotton mills, you know, by the way. And he worked at a mill with a bloke called Tony Fontaine. That was his real name.
Right.
So we dicked his name and made it Tony and the Fontaines. So... Well, that was an easy one.
That's, yeah, I mean, but as you know, as good as any name I've ever heard is Tony and the Fontaines.
Yeah.
I love these band names. I mean, some of them are so evocative and so absolutely sweet. Others are not so, but, you know, that's a, that, for me, is a typical, great, fantastic name of a 60s band.
Well, Tony after that, Bill, it came...
And the material you were doing.
The Fabulous Fontaines.
The Fabulous Fontaines.
You know, which is even sounds better.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sounds better than it was, anyway.
Yeah, yeah. And that material was Shadows, take it?
No.
So it
no.
wasn't to take on Cliff no, Richard no, and the Shadows no, or anything no. like that?
By about... I can tell you, it changed not long after leaving school. We were doing, like, Shadows-type stuff, and then... What my turning point in my life, Bill, was when I saw Screaming Lord Sutch and the Savages.
Really?
Really.
Yeah.
In 1962 at the Floral.
Yeah.
Of course, they had Richie Blackmore on guitar, Carlo Little on drums.
Yeah.
Strawberry on Strawberry Watson.
Right.
Also on guitar, and Ricky Fenson on bass, and Freddie Lee on piano.
Yep.
And
fantastic.
Had to be the greatest rock and roll band that's ever been in this country.
Right. Yeah.
Anyway, that changed it all, yeah. Bill. And that's, you know, we kind of stopped doing the Shadows type stuff and went on to do the aggressive Jerry Lee, Chuck Berry, that type of stuff.
That was kind of what we might traditionally call the rockers, the rock and roll rockers, as it were. Teddy Boys, were you Teddy Boys, or were you...
Well, we were too late for the Teddy Boy era, but certainly in 62, 63,
I know
there was still a lot of Teds around, Teddy Boys, and especially up in Barra and Kendall.
Yeah.
I mean, they were knocking around in Teddy Boy suits till about 1965.
Were they? Yeah. You haven't caught up then with the rest of the world?
No,
what were we wearing? I can't remember then. What were we wearing?
Pretty
soon is
what I still wear.
Smart suits.
Slick suits.
What would we call them ties that were very thin? What were they called?
Bootlace ties.
Bootlace ties.
Slim Jim tie.
Yeah, what was it? Black velvet collar? Black velvet collar on the back of the suit? Yeah. No turn-ups on your trousers?
Yeah, we did have turn-ups, actually. Large turn-ups.
Oh, right.
Yeah, about 2-inch, two-inch turn-ups were pretty big.
Did you go to Burton's and kind of get it all, or did all this?
Of course we did,
I did.
Burton's got my first suit, actually, when I was at school.
And you were...
Slightly longer jacket.
That's it.
You know,
what about vents in back? No vents?
Oh, no.
No, no, that was all.
None of that.
I mean... Absolutely amazing.
Flaps on, two top pockets with flaps on.
All right, yeah, no, yeah.
Half a velvet collar.
What about the flies? Were they still buttoned up then, with those zips? Can you remember? When did they go on to zip the fly?
I think you might be right. I think the zip came in maybe about,
64, I know.
And they were a little bit effeminate, really.
I suppose, yeah. You know, yeah. Buttons.
They
weren't a macho.
They weren't a man's
buttons.
Thing. Zip flies.
Aye.
Only girls had zips in
skirts. Of course they did. Yeah.
You know.
Side of the skirt.
Yeah.
Zip my skirt up, love. Does my bum look big in this? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Fantastic. I know. Just that the things you get onto. Yeah.
So we started doing.
Andy played in a band as well. Go on.
We started doing. we started doing the more aggressive stuff.
Yeah.
And it kind of took off, and we stuck to that for quite a while.
Yeah.
And then it changed again, which I'll tell you about if you want to, if you've got time.
Oh well,
after this track.
Yeah, we'll look at this next track for you. What take us through and what is it?
This track. If it's the right one, it's in a pub. It's a Chuck Berry number. And it was done in a pub in the 70s. I mean, by the way, the band split up. The singer went to be a policeman.
Right.
And when he'd done his so many years in the police, retiring, the band got back together for a short time. And we did a few pub gigs, and this is one of them. This is in the Red Well.
Talking what year would
this,
you say this?
This is in the late 70s.
Bro. Right, okay. Yeah, late 70s and...
Short of the five-man truck, you know, we never was a minute late. But we were 90 miles. your engine, just move your wings and let me make it to the telephone. Los Angeles, give me number, Virginia, try 44-1009. The telephone's back home, this is the promised land calling, the poor boy's on.
So, we've heard some fascinating stuff here from Golly, and he's going to take us on again and get us kind of... I think we're exploring round about the mid-60s now, aren't we?
Yeah.
We've done a little bit of 1964. The Fontaines then got you then playing at places like the Floral Hall in Morecambe, and then you found a band called Screaming Lord Sutch, and the Savages, and that changed everything, you said.
It did, yeah, it sure did. And I worked with Screaming Lord Sutch, you know, much later on. And he said to me, Bill, he said you should have been a Savage.
Right.
I said, I know I should. and I got to be perfectly honest, believe it or believe it not, but if I could have had a choice of which band to join in the 60s,
yeah.
If somebody said, hey, Golly, you know, do you want to join the Beatles? Do you want to join the Stones? Do you want to join the Kinks or whatever?
Yeah.
Or do you want to join the Savages?
Yeah.
It would have been the Savages, Bill.
Now then.
And they were on £4 a night.
£4 a night?
Because Sutch only ever given £4.
Right.
So he was well known as being tight.
Also,
he used to give them £4.
Right. So that he paid the band an individual wage of £4
yes,
each.
Yes, he did, yes.
Was that a good wage or not in those days? What kind
well,
of
well, for them early days, and they were busy, you know, they would have been about 5-6 nights a week.
Yeah.
So they would have been getting, what, £25 a week.
Yeah, well, that was okay.
I was getting okay. £3 a week, though.
I can remember, yeah, well, I remember. An apprentice.
Working hard, yeah. You know, doing a man's job, £3 a week.
I think I remember the first day I broke a fiver. You know, we actually made a £5 note in my wages.
You were well off.
Absolutely, yeah.
You were well off, man.
Yeah. So, yeah. So that did it for you. Again, you moved on and upwards and, again, inspired by a band called The Savages then, you know. And you said you should
definitely
have been one. I mean, and what... Did you get to know them personally?
No, I didn't, because they were a London band.
Yeah, of course they were.
But, you know, they used to travel around the country, yeah. And now and again we would get to see them.
Yeah, yeah.
But another great band of that time, Bill, was Johnny Kidd and the Pirates.
Well, of course. Well, yeah. The opening track of the show was Johnny Kidd and the Pirates tonight, so
there
that,
you go.
If I can jump in nicely to that one.
Jumping on that one, my brother played bass.
Your brother played bass?
With them for a while,
Your brother's name?
Dave.
Yeah. Dave Holroyd.
Yeah.
Dave Holroyd played bass on...
Well, he's called Dave Howard Holroyd, right, to be...
With the Pirates, Skip.
With the Pirates.
He played with Bowie, originally. David Jones and the King Bees.
Ah, right. And David Jones is none other than...
David Bowie.
So, what a connection that is. Fantastic.
And then, apparently, he had a falling out due with his band, the Pirates.
Yeah.
And he was left with no band. So, The King Bees went and
backed
him on a tour.
Fantastic. That's all a connection again.
Yeah. I remember that name, the King Bees. I remember that.
Yeah. Yeah. All on Lanky Beat website, folks. You can go back down there and have a look down. So you'll find it eventually.
There's connections all around, isn't there?
Yeah, there are, absolutely. Yeah. It's lovely to find these connections too. Yeah. I mean, I'm going on now... After the Fontaines, moving on to, you know, are we getting mid-60s going up to 70s? And
well, yeah, we went to London in 64, 65. We're playing down there, doing clubs.
As in, moved down physically?
Yeah,
moved. Lock, Stock and Barrel?
Oh, yeah.
Lived down there. And went for it?
Yeah, went for it. Mm. And we were doing all right. And I didn't find out till quite a long time, till a couple of years later. But, you know, we had opportunities to go
you know, over to Europe, France, Germany, yeah. all the spots. Yeah. I was too young, of course. Right. I was 17. You had to be 18.
You did.
And too naive ever to try and bluff my way over there.
Yeah.
Or say I was going on a holiday or lying about my age, you know.
Yeah.
Never entered my head, Bill.
No.
So
no.
We kind of hung around till August,
yeah.
To my 18th birthday. But in the meantime, I got a telegram. I've only ever had one telegram in my life, and I've still got it.
Right.
And it was offering me a job coming back to Morecambe to do a summer season. So right. I came back.
Right.
And was playing 7 nights a week in the Tivoli on Morecambe Promenade, right up till about New Year. And then, which would be New Year 60, 65.
Yeah.
And then, same as everybody else, I was skint.
Yeah.
Terrified to get a job.
Yeah, a proper job.
A proper job.
Yeah.
Because I'd only ever worked for a few months in
yeah.
school.
Yeah.
So scared to death of getting a proper job, and that's kind of how I got into the antique business.
I believe you're well into the antique business.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, it's.
And that's when I met Pete Hayes, which is Paul Hayes' dad, which is another story, Bill, that we'll go over some
yeah.
other time. You know.
Yeah, well, yeah. I think
Paul is now a rock and roll singer as well as
yeah.
you know TV.
This is Paul Hayes, who I mentioned before about a superstar on TV, Cash in the Attic, isn't he? And Paul plays in lead singer, and Golly is his lead guitarist in the band, and they do quite a bit of work around the area. But before all that, this is the here and now, isn't it?
Yeah.
Before the here and now, I'm really more interested in your earlier days and
yeah.
Taking it up to the 70s, 80s. We've got to get to that yet, haven't we?
Yeah. Well, I met a fella who'd just come. Well, he'd actually been a student at Lancashire University, Derek Jackson, or
yep.
Thunder Jackson, as he calls himself.
Thunder Jackson.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's pretty good, and I hope you can put a track on.
We'll get this next track lined
Thunder
up.
Thunder Jackson and Citizens Band.
Right.
From the 70s again.
Off every temple, I won't be your fool no more. Take me outside, beef and ale, huh? Your turn. We'll be right back.
Keys. That's the final track we'll be playing tonight from Golly Goulding. And just to kind of wind up, I hope you've enjoyed the show tonight, Golly. And I'm just interested to know what your real name is.
Real name, Steve Goulding.
Steve?
Yeah. And do you want to know how I got the name?
Oh, of course I do. We're all gagging here.
Right, well, it's dead, easy again, this one, Bill.
Right.
excuse me. When we were at school, about five-year-old, I sat next to my cousin in class, and we were learning to write each other's name. So he's writing my name, Steve, he's getting there. So he's got Step Hen. Two words, you see, dead easy.
Step Hen, yeah.
Yeah. He mastered that.
Right.
So he's writing Goulding, so he gets G-O-L-E, and that's as far as he could get. And he says, Golly, that's Gollywog. And it bloody stuck from there.
Yeah.
So I've had that nickname, Bill, for 60 years.
Right.
And I've still got my mum, God bless her, she's 89.
Fantastic.
And there's only my mum and maybe a couple of old relatives that call me Steve.
Right.
Everybody else calls me Golly.
Right.
And that's how it started with my cousin.
Well, there's nothing wrong with that. I love the name Golly. And equally with Peter over here, whose name is Skip. These are rock and roll names. Yeah. They're rock and roll names, even though, in terms of Peter over there, it'd been an Australian Skippy name, wouldn't it? If everybody even saw it. It doesn't half suit somehow, doesn't it? So, yeah, it's great. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's about it. I've had a ball tonight listening to these stories. It's been a fantastic time for me. I hope you've enjoyed yourselves, and thank you very much, Golly.
And thanks for asking us.
You're welcome.
Yeah, again.
And to you, Skip.
Yeah, thanks, Bill.
Yeah, I'm glad you've enjoyed it. This is the Lanky Beat Show. We are on Writington Hospital Radio, and we'll see you again sometime very soon.
I took a drink, stir it up. I didn't know if it was day or night.
Drink it.
started kissing everything in sight. But when I kissed the cop down at 34th and Vine, he broke my little bottle.